Hi, this is Lynn from WisconsinGarden.com, and this is part three of What's Blooming in Our Garden. You've seen a lot so far. I hope you enjoy what you see next. This is an angel flower, angel lily, moon lily. Some people, they have different names for them. All we know is that we were told that this particular group came from Poland with the woman's father. And they have big white trumpets that kind of hang down if they have the ability to do that. They were supposed to be not real hardy and probably wouldn't come back, we were told. They have come back. They are not sheltered. This is the north side of the property. Hers were on the south side next to the house, but they came back. They are very poisonous, so you have to keep that in mind. The leaves are poisoned, the flowers are poisoned, the whole thing is poisoned.
Well, I think you have one over on the south side that escaped.
Yeah.
Let's go look at
that
one.
How did that get there? The unique thing about these, not only is the flower very beautiful and the leaves are very pretty, but their seed pods are like little sputniks. They're round and they have pointy little spikes all the way around them, and then the seeds are inside of that yet. So
it's like a sea urchin.
Yes, that does look like a sea urchin, and inside are little brown seeds when they're ready.
Let's go look at that one over there.
Now, how did this one get way over here? Especially when you think the seeds are poisoned, so I don't think the birds are eating them, but obviously someone moved a pod of seeds over here. But isn't that just, it's a gorgeous flower.
I
love these little points on the tips.
I mean, that has to be, I'd say 8 inches long, 9 inches long.
And this is how they look when they first start. This looks like
tightly wrapped a cigar.
Yep.
A flower cigar.
You don't want to be smoking it.
Okay, I won't.
Good.
I don't smoke anyhow.
Well, we wanted to show you purple coneflower, so we've shown you yellow and an orange. This is probably the most prolific of the coneflowers. These poor little guys, we moved when we were doing another project, and they had to be moved, and it was really hot. But they have survived. They are tough. And then next door here, we got this plant from one of the master gardeners. She brought them from her yard, and she wasn't happy with how they looked, and so she said, why don't you just take them, because I don't think we can sell them. This is sea holly? Sea holly, right. And we had some on the south driveway that didn't come back this year, and now we have some more.
They are prolific.
Yes.
They and will spread.
The bumblebees love them. They just love them, so I'm going to have to lift those up, because they're much more impressive when they're standing up taller than flopped all over the ground. Sometimes you get things growing in your compost bin, and that's happened to us a couple of times. This year, I think what's growing in here is a butternut squash, which was the kind of squash that we bought and tried to grow in our squash garden, and it didn't take. The seeds that I put in here as compost from our last year batch after we ate, you know, the squash, has sprouted, and now we have a butternut squash growing in our better built compost bin.
Well, you have tomatoes back there that are trying to grow.
Yep. So
weeds, obviously.
Yep. The beautiful blossoms again.
Edible.
You know, you can eat those. You'd have to obviously wash off all those ants, but they are fun and beautiful, and thank goodness they turn into squash.
And how about the bat we rescued yesterday, and we actually put over here at the base of the tree?
Yes, we did.
And he was hanging upside down all afternoon and evening,
right,
when
resting.
You checked.
Yes.
But this morning when you looked, he was gone.
He has gone. So our neighbor found him on her patio. She was worried that he was going to get toasted sitting on a patio brick, and she learned that bats cannot take off from the ground. They have to be up on a vertical plane so that they can take off.
See, is it? I wonder if putting a couple drops of water on it would.
Our little pond is a very quiet area. It's kind of overgrown with our ground cover, but that's fine because it gives the frogs a nice inviting place to come out and sun. And I have seen at least one frog here already. The goldfish are in there nibbling. You can kind of hear them as they come up and take little nibbles off of algae or plants. In front of that, the purple is lantana that seeds itself each year. We don't plant that. And then burrow's tail that somehow got up here. And that too, I kind of keep that under control because that can get a little prolific. Behind me is another giant fleece plant that's in a place where we can let it actually get big without a problem. The poor mum underneath it doesn't always appreciate it, but.
No, you can cut some of the lower ones back.
True, true. And then I like to have a little flower area here under our poor plum tree.
Well, this has to be cut down, and the only thing we're going to save is this one branch. It's the only thing that is growing.
This is the second year now. We've given it 2 years to see if it was going to recover, and it hasn't, just that one branch and then this one. Well, that is from that
branch,
too.
That's off the same branch, mm-hmm. Yeah.
So, again, we've got Coreopsis in here. I put some of Tim's zinnias back here, the little seedlings. That's how the rose mallow begins, when it's just starting.
Yep. Well, Coreopsis is also called tick seed, right?
Right.
Yeah. So, and more balloon flowers. Mm-hmm.
And snapdragons that seeded themselves, and coral bells. I mean, look at these snapdragons. They are growing in a crack between two pieces of wood. They're just amazing. And then we have water lilies in the pond.
Oh, yeah.
And more goldfish. And sometimes we get bullfrogs that somehow get up into this pond.
Well, I have seen many toads this year. Good sized toads, almost half a palm size.
Love toads.
Yes.
They're great. You want them in your garden, they eat mosquitoes.
You know what I haven't seen in a long time?
What's that?
A salamander.
No. Well, I don't think
we're not wet enough.
Wet enough conditions anymore, which is possibly a good thing, I suppose. Mm-hmm. And then this was the, help me out, what kind of flower was this?
Well, that too seeded itself, lupine. Came back. Lupine,
yes.
Came back
by
itself.
This is the lupine, yes. And it really is happy. You can see all the new growth. So hopefully next year there won't be a question about whether it comes back or not comes back. And
well, that's a biennial though, isn't it?
I don't know.
I think so.
I don't know. But I cut off most of the blossoms, but I left a few so I can reseed.
Good.
This is one of our mini hostas that we bought at the...
And look at it bloom.
And it's blooming tiny little flowers.
Yeah.
So not all hostas are giant. They come in all forms. They have even tiny, tiny ones that we saw one day at a hosta lover's garden tour. It was amazing.
Well, there are thousands of different species, yes, of varieties, I should say, of hosta.
There are.
That's amazing. I think we're going to have to start inviting master gardeners over to clarify that our labeling is correct.
That and to help us.
And help us with the ones we don't know.
Right. Because sometimes when you buy them, it just says hosta, and you have no idea with all the hundreds and thousands of varieties which ones you actually have. So.
Well, maybe we need to put an email out to everybody and say, you know, master gardeners wanted to help us clarify our plant markers.
Mm-hmm. Another thing we bought this year that is really interesting, and I really like it, is this rubra. I think it's in the spinach family. It tastes like spinach, but it doesn't have the tall leaves that get all sandy and hard to clean. And they're just these nice little round, meaty leaves.
And look at the black berries down at the bottom.
Yep,
I mean, they're just full of berries.
It keeps blossoming and berry, you know, making berries.
So those are the seeds.
Those would be the seeds.
For next year.
Correct. But this is just perfect because you can just take two and put it on a sandwich and there you have your...
Like a lettuce wrap. A spinach wrap.
Or just a, inside your sandwich even. But they're meaty. They're thick. They're not like you're like a piece of lettuce. They're thicker. Mm-hmm. Yeah, you can have some. But they definitely have a spinachy taste. And then suddenly they're gone. They just vanish in your mouth. I don't know how it does that. But this will grow all season long. It doesn't seem to have the cool weather to make it grow. This just is getting taller and taller, and it'll grow all the way until fall. So that'll be cool. My archway, the flamingos, but look at how prolific the morning glories are becoming. And the contrast of the green and the red is really exciting.
That could be your holiday card.
Thank you, Tim. We never got to this area in the spring. It has double tulips in here that come out white and turn pink. But it was full of weeds and it was full of plants that I didn't want. The hibiscus that is here, we don't remember what color it is.
I think that was a red one, if I remember correctly.
We're going to find out soon because it's about to bloom. And then more sedum. Yeah. And in the background, you can see the allium stalks that are still there, which we're going to be doing something with shortly.
And your clematis?
The clematis is a blue clematis. It doesn't seem to crawl as high as the other clematis that we have, but it's very bushy. And then this is the end of the Japanese fernleaf peony. It's obviously not at its best, but it was gorgeous when it was here. But this is how it looks, and I'll probably be cutting part of that back for now, just for appearance sake. Japanese iris are back here. We have another monk's hood, tall over there. Hosta, more allium. Those are the large ones. This is an aster that blooms very late in the fall, which gives us a nice purple color. And these are tea roses that are, we've had these for a long time. We've cut them back. But they are, once they start blooming, they are prolific.
It's like they don't stop. I mean, it's just like a sea of red.
Yes, and they're brilliantly red. Yeah. They're scarlet red. This is a nice little area that we rescued from some plants that got out of control. Our friend Bob gave us these beautiful tuberous begonias that have just delighted us for weeks now.
Mm-hmm.
The flowers are amazing.
And you got coleus
in here. Coleus that we saved over the winter from our last year's garden.
And all your lilies that you transplanted?
Yes, these are all the bright yellow lilies, and then some yellow yarrow. This is the good kind. There are some yarrows that spread like wildfire. This one does not. This one stays where it's supposed to be. And then different hostas growing under another maple tree.
And all of your baby tree peonies.
Yes, they are doing wonderfully.
Yeah.
We're going to be potting those up this fall and then sinking the pots.
I see you have dozens of tomatoes that need picking today. Dozens. That's amazing.
It's very good. If you've enjoyed this video and the tour of our garden and what's blooming, please give us a thumbs up. It'll help support our Wisconsin blog. And if you'd like to comment, leave questions, we'd love to hear those. And if you'd like to become part of our garden family, please subscribe. Love to have you.
And connect with us on YouTube.